2007 is repeatedly cited as one of gaming's golden years, and one of the titles that contributed to the year's outstanding quality was BioWare's foray into science fiction. Regardless of its issues, Mass Effect was a massive success, financially, critically, and publicly. At this stage, BioWare was established as a top-tier developer. After Star Wars, Jade Empire, and Mass Effect, they weren't simply a D&D player's best friend. They were able to elevate each brand and world encountered, able to make not just a great Star Wars, martial arts, or sci-fi game, but a great game, period. But BioWare were always looking to expand, broadening horizons technically, creatively, or financially. And 2007 was a year that expansion would come to the company itself. BioWare was acquired only a month prior to Mass Effect's launch. This purchase had been in the making for some time. In 2005, BioWare and Pandemic Studios joined forces, organized by VG Holding Corp with a private equity fund, Elevation Partners, investing. John Riccitiello was heavily involved in both, and was rehired by EA in April 2007 to become its CEO, acquiring both game developers in October of that year. BioWare was always successful, but they weren't at the forefront of mainstream gaming in the same way that Bungie, Rockstar, or Epic had been in the same number of years. Fully backed by one of gaming's largest publishers, BioWare collected all of the data possible on Mass Effect's reception, ready to polish their sequel for a new audience. Mass Effect's issues were well cataloged, as everything from texture loading in elevators to Mako physics and samey visuals were immediately identifiable. In response, BioWare had obtained as many of the game's core issues into an Excel sheet as possible and got to work. Being a new IP, much of Mass Effect's development came down to compromise and tight scheduling. A large contributor to this was the team's development structure. Employees focused almost entirely on their exclusive disciplines. Coupled with new technology that rapidly evolved over development, and BioWare found themselves having to constantly readjust levels and assets, rarely creating a playable build. The chaos hindered everybody from designers to quality assurance. New creatures didn't have playable levels to be used in, forcing designers to experiment with them in test levels, ones that weren't accurate representations of the final product. Quality assurance couldn't report on issues in any greater detail than it's busted. And content couldn't be reviewed until the end of the project, forcing some to be cut due to the lack of time and development. All of this was soul-crushing and expensive. Thankfully, the completion of Mass Effect brought its makers out of the mud. The foundation of their universe was completed, a blueprint was founded, and now it was time to improve it. Development was restructured to make for a far more efficient schedule, with clear deliverables, design goals, and deadlines. Instead of redesigning combat entirely months before shipping, Mass Effect 2 was playable from beginning to end in Christmas of 2009. Having solved many of Mass Effect's internal struggles, the question became what to improve during this time. In partnering with EA, the company wanted their games to reach as many people as possible. Each title was a response of some sort to a common criticism thrown at BioWare. Too much reading, Star Wars. Turn-based combat, Jade Empire. Non-voice protagonist, Mass Effect. The issues to resolve now were many of the speed bumps I discussed previously. Clunky combat, repetitive environments, load times, etc. BioWare seemingly didn't want anything to potentially slow down the user's experience. There's very little information on Mass Effect 2's story development, though it's easy to discover that the marketing's repeated assurance that Mass Effect's a planned trilogy was overreaching.
So that's two, and you guys, you've been pretty public in mentioning that you planned this out as a trilogy from the get-go, right?
Yeah, the three-act story is the story that's been there from the very beginning.
According to the game's lead writer, Cerberus were simply an evil corporation dropped into Mass Effect whenever necessary. The idea of the organization playing a prominent role in Mass Effect 2 was developed during the sequel's production cycle and wasn't set in stone prior. Elements of the story from Commander Shepard's opening death to Legion's character may have appeared to be planned based on Mass Effect 2's reveal, but it was all made on the fly. While the story was being cobbled together, Mass Effect's designers were relatively clear on what they wanted, aiming their combat system to rival that of a full-on action game. The idea being that a shooter coupled with BioWare's dialogue and characters would make it stand out to a crowd unfamiliar with the company. Mass Effect's universe retained its depth and complexity, but the gameplay was elevated in priority. Mass Effect's a trinity of combat, conversation, and exploration. It was an effective combination as it worked for all kinds of players. Those who wanted to focus on the main narrative shot and talked their way through saving the galaxy, while the curious drove around dozens of uncharted landscapes, piecing together each and every detail about this universe. Being a first attempt, BioWare had their share of challenges, founding each pillar with new techniques. Real-time combat and vehicles were massively improved from the studio's previous work, and the leap made from Mass Effect 2 this sequel is the presentation from top to bottom. Unlike most titles that bump up a few textures between releases, the production quality in Mass Effect 2 has a profound effect on combat. Multiple hitboxes are an improvement in and of themselves, but the multitude of states an enemy is in depending on where, what, and how you hit them is impressive to this day. Severing a mech's legs, watching a soldier's gas tank explode, or taking cover from an Emir's self-destruction is not only satisfying, but it helps sell that these are real enemies in a real place. Audio is the next largest contributor. Rob Blake was hired as the game's lead sound designer in 2008, and with a team of 10 people, retooled all of the effects from Mass Effect and placed them into a more sophisticated audio engine. While shotguns and assault rifles don't pack the same beefy punch, the attention to detail in weapons, environments, and ambience more than makes up for it. It's a far cry from the three layers of audio often found in Mass Effect's isolated side missions. Resolving Mass Effect's texture and framerate issues and the amount of time paused during action, the moment-to-moment encounters in Mass Effect 2 are a definite improvement over its predecessor. BioWare's goal of making the game feel noticeably smoother had been achieved. Design was also improved in many areas. Vanguard, Sentinel, and Infiltrator were expanded from being hybrids and granted exclusive abilities. Power and weapon combinations were far more balanced. While the original pummels players in the early hours, there are multiple ways to snap the game's combat in two, with build and weapon exploits, ranging from explosive shotgun ammunition to the soldier's invulnerability that could be recharged instantly with adrenaline burst. Shepard's power is immense by Mass Effect 2's conclusion, but not to the same degree of insanity. Everything rough about the controls, balance, and tech were elegantly repaired, allowing for a far more relaxed gaming experience. But that's where Mass Effect 2 has lost something during its pursuit for accessible combat. Cover, sprint, shields, and metagel have all been retooled to reflect the mechanics of 7th-gen squad-based third-person shooters. While removing the original's clunkiness, common issues with this subgenre of action appear. Ignoring the critique of unappealing chest-high walls cluttering the environment, the placement of cover more importantly makes arenas predictable. The shift from quiet walk to firefights is telegraphed several steps ahead of music cues or enemy spawns. Ambushes that are meant to surprise consistently falter due to this overt protection. That predictability extends to the enemy behavior. The artificial intelligence isn't as sporadic, but it's certainly dense. Exposing themselves with low health, missing shots, or outright not firing are frequent. Balance is important, and Mass Effect felt occasionally cheap, but enemies such as the Krogan or shotgun wielders instilled a sense of tension. Witnessing a Battlemaster charge or a soldier switch to his close-range death cannon was always unnerving, as it forced you to time your powers correctly or else leading to your death. That sense of danger hasn't translated, and species such as the Krogan are relatively nerfed in the sequel, and enemy shotguns don't put you into critical nearly as quickly. Predictable level design coupled with cautious AI highlights another common issue that plagues action games, first and third person. When stop-and-pop shooting utilizes regenerating shields and health, it only punishes in the most desperate and aggressive encounters. Weak NPCs with non-regenerating health against a strong player with regenerating health stacks the odds dramatically in one's favor. From easy to insanity, the best strategy of all is to enter cover and take accurate pop shots at the same enemies until they fall down, occasionally spamming an ally's power. If the shots aren't missed and tank enemies don't get close, it's a plan with overwhelmingly positive outcomes. Speaking of allies, that's another aspect lacking spontaneity in combat, as they only have a total of 3 abilities maximum. This decision stemmed from the controls and desire to avoid paused action as frequently as the Xbox 360 version of Mass Effect. In the sequel, squad positioning and target designation are mapped to the same keys, and when an enemy is highlighted, your ally will use one of their powers. Restricting each character to 3 abilities means that the game will grant a high damage power each time you press the key, but it also contributes to the predictability of combat. Enemies are only less of a threat when it's known that one button press will have Garrus immediately knock him out without any strategy or planning. To be fair, combining the powers of you and your allies does result in very satisfying destruction, but the occasions when it all comes together is surprisingly rare, and more of a visual spectacle than strategic mastery. The low frequency of this is also due to level design. Not only are they laced with telegraphic ambushes, but the game has a bad habit of placing enemies with rocket launchers outside of your reach. For snipers, it isn't a big deal, but for aggressive classes like the Vanguard, it really hurts the pacing of the game when you need to take cover and slowly finish them off with your pistol. And you can't spam shots at these enemies because of the introduction of heat sinks. BioWare swapped out Mass Effect's energy-based weapons with ammunition. It's a change that I prefer on certain weapons such as the shotgun, but there isn't a reason listed as to why we can't have both types. Being able to decide between energy and ammunition would have added some depth to the frankly small pool of weapons that the game features, and would have avoided the poor explanation through lore that many have rightfully poked fun at for years, adding consistencies and plot holes. Meanwhile, adjustments such as shared cooldowns are simply changed without any lore explanation. But while the balancing has been improved, it can still be exploited, mainly through the research upgrade that grants Shepard access to any of his squad members' loyalty abilities, letting Vanguards also have barriers and become nearly unstoppable. Mass Effect 2's combat is a definite improvement in terms of input and feel, but it's lost the original strategy intention. And while its cover system and shooting may have been satisfying at the time, with the plethora of cover-based shooters over the years, it's only served to age the title. Missions such as Garrus's recruitment don't even require you to participate in combat, content with spamming squad commands, whereas the derelict Reaper demonstrates how incompetent your companions are at close range. It's all over the place, and improvements made to the moment-to-moment gameplay aren't strong enough to shake the notion that BioWare's titles stand out for their character, plotlines, and quests, rather than combat. When Mass Effect's dialogue wheel was first introduced, BioWare demonstrated how the player would be able to interrupt other speakers, making for a more immersive experience. But in the finished product, the interrupts weren't present. Interviews tried to spin it as the A button being talk and X being interrupt, but X was really just a skip button. The feature was quietly brushed aside during production, likely due to Mass Effect's chaotic development and issues of having interrupts be connected to the wheel. There isn't anything in this picture to communicate to the player that the option is going to interrupt your companion, and this conversation was specifically made for the X06 demo and not the game. For this sequel, the dialogue system's unchanged on the surface, with the largest addition being the interrupts, bringing BioWare's idea from the original to life, allowing you to help a racist or throw mercs out a window. Paragon interrupts always grant a large boost to your meter, and the Renegade interrupts are often hysterical.
Give me a name or I'll cut your balls off and sell them to a Krogan.
It's a neat concept, and most of the interrupts are worthwhile inclusions, and the issues it has are just a symptom of a greater issue. Previously, I discussed the dialogue wheel's uneven paraphrasing and the questionable alignments of Paragon and Renegade, and the sequel inflates both. Largely taking place in the Terminus system, away from the calm and protected council space, Mass Effect 2 explores a darker side of the galaxy, constantly dealing with criminals, mercenaries, and the corrupt. Understandably, this shift in tone is felt in dialogue. The conversation between characters has generally improved, with sharper lines and memorable quips. Some are quoted by fans today.
Geth, do not infiltrate.
You should leave your personal synthetic assistant at home. They're not allowed on public shuttles anymore.
Geth, do not intentionally infiltrate.
But the wheel itself has everything discussed before, from Shepard always directing conversation, paraphrases being the same as separate lines of dialogue.
If I have to, do I have to?
And Paragon and Renegade's inconsistencies. That last problem is what's enlarged here. Mass Effect had a hard enough time keeping Paragon and Renegade decisions aligned with compassion and ruthlessness, and in the sequel, Paragon has dialogue and physical actions that seem awfully Renegade. Shoving civilians and grabbing a C-Sec officer by the throat doesn't strike one as empathetic. The best example of this binary morality in a morally gray situation is on Legion's loyalty mission. Shepard enters a station to either destroy all of the heretics aboard it or overwrite their viewpoints with ones that align with Legion and the rest of the Geth. Tali condemns the latter as she accurately assesses that to brainwash because their views don't align with ours is nonsensical, but the only other option is to destroy them. The game effectively raises a morally gray scenario, but the game needs to attribute each option to Paragon or Renegade, and aligns brainwashing the enemy with being a Paragon. Had Mass Effect's skill tree exist, or at least retain the option to invest points in either Intimidate or Charm, the game could have had Legion's mission grant you a healthy amount of experience points, allowing you to further your conversation choices in either category. But due to its removal, and because of the loyalty mechanic being attached to conversations that require a certain amount of either discipline, this level must distribute Paragon and Renegade points, even if the mission isn't nearly black and white enough for it to make sense. Speaking of which, there's the loyalty mechanic, and I use the term loosely. Unlike Dragon Age Origins, that tracks your companion's like or dislike of you with a meter, here, whether or not your companions are loyal to you is yet another binary state, pertaining to whether or not you do their personal missions. The concept of gaining the trust and respect of your companions for a suicide mission is a novel one, but the execution doesn't hold under scrutiny. Twice, your squad mates will go at each other's throats after completing both their loyalty missions, on three separate occasions assisting in deeply personal matters that haven't been addressed by their friends or family. And yet, siding with one immediately unfriends the other, leaving them to probable death. Honestly expecting one to believe that because of one lost argument, the character won't use all of their power in a life or death situation. But in order to prevent any death happening among your squad, you require 75 points in either field for Tally and Legion, and 100% for Miranda and Jack. You're effectively forced to go fully Paragon or Renegade for every option until you fill one of the meters, which is damaging in a game that is about roleplaying and saying what you want. And because the game grants you Paragon points for nearly every little conversation and minute quest, the game has an overt bias towards playing hero over anti-hero. Conversation does play a large role in Mass Effect 2, but the believability has diminished due to how it connects to other mechanics. As before, it's a shame because only a few changes could have avoided these faults, some of which only exist due to something removed from the original game. But the dialogue wasn't hit the hardest by Mass Effect 2's absent designs. That'd be the exploration. BioWare received fair critiques pertaining to the first game's uncharted worlds. Repetitive assets, objectives, and scenery were coupled with non-existent production values, making for quests that, while having some thought-provoking finales, were too much of a grind for many players to enjoy. That, or the Mako just made them motion sick. Early interviews hinted at BioWare improving the Mako's controls and fleshing out the uncharted worlds for Mass Effect 2.
The Uncharted Worlds, which was an area of feedback we got on the first game, you know, the Mako controls have been completely redone, so you have new vehicle controls, and we also really focused on making those Uncharted Worlds feel handcrafted and exotic and really interesting. There's a lot of cool stuff going on. They're completely optional still, but they're going to enhance the main story arc. So if you go to them and actually do some of the Uncharted World plots, you might enhance some of the backstories of your companion characters. They might actually make the main game actually flow that much better.
But with the amount of missions pertaining to your main squad, there simply weren't enough hours in the day to make Uncharted Worlds 2.0 work, and BioWare scrapped it entirely. What the company seemed to take away the most from people's criticism of Mass Effect side missions is how they didn't feel attached to the main quest, that accomplishing them was simply dragging on the game's runtime instead of providing anything useful for Shepard or the main narrative. With the sequel's premise being to prepare for a suicide mission, BioWare attached exploration to gathering resources necessary for upgrading the Normandy to prevent your squad from being killed. But while BioWare may have accomplished this technically, it has come at a great cost. The Mako sections may have been occasionally frustrating, but it added to variety, and the levels differed in structure from the main quest. In Mass Effect 2, the side activity attached to your main quest is scanning planets for resources, a minigame that doesn't engage due to it entirely being a time sink. Mass Effect overused its hacking mechanic, but at least it required some resemblance of attention from the player to succeed. Resource mining only requires glancing at these 4 meters. Meanwhile, actual side missions don't have any effect on the main quest, and due to the removal of vehicles, they end up only repeating mechanics with lower production values or use gimmicks the game's input wasn't made for. There's genuinely more to learn about the universe reading planet descriptions than participating in these side missions. In fact, one of the benefits of Mass Effect 2's revamped galaxy map is that it does immerse the player in space more effectively. Mass Effect's planet descriptions often had connections to the world, making them engaging to read, but the sequel improves on it with far less single-sentence descriptions and having every planet rotate in orbit instead of remaining still. Some of the stories in these descriptions could easily be their own novel, miniseries, or game if the opportunity arises, but it's rather a shame that the most enjoyable aspect of Mass Effect 2's exploration is the least interactive. In terms of setting tone, Mass Effect 2's opening is one of the best. Within minutes, the game is establishing more grit, violence, and ambience than its predecessor. BioWare wanted to illustrate how much their presentation had improved in 3 years, and of all the ways to do so, destroying a ship players had grown an attachment to at the very beginning is a great place to start. It's no accident that the lighting during your first steps is polar opposite to Mass Effect's blues. The Kelvin value has flipped, in coordination with Shepard's peril. To separate Mass Effect's love interest, destroy the Normandy, and have them isolated in space is effective, and establishes Mass Effect 2's themes and goals. It would be perfect had it not encaptured Mass Effect 2's greatest fault. Mass Effect established a universe brilliantly, but as discussed, there's not many scenes that emotionally resonate. and wanting to make a darker chapter, there needed to be a greater sense of drama in the sequel. Commander Shepard being killed is about as dramatic as you can get, but the issue is that the drama only exists for the immediate moment without any benefit to the greater narrative. Commander Shepard being spaced and flung towards a planet where he's presumably melted to ash upon hitting the ozone layer is a tragic image, but being science fiction, there isn't much room left to elegantly explain how Shepard comes back from the dead, and the game only grants hand-wave explanations. Lots of money was spent bringing Shepard back, is all the depth extracted. Commander Shepard's death is only used as an attempt to highlight Mass Effect 2's drama, but its narrative doesn't have the plot or conflict to make this necessary. There isn't anything in this opening that couldn't have been done with Shepard going into a coma, even from the perspective of visual spectacle. The image of Shepard flying towards the planet is dramatic, but it's not the only one that was possible of achieving such devastation. Shepard drifting through space isolated from anyone could have achieved the same emotional shock, or even allow a first-person view as Shepard fights for his life as a callback to the original's opening with Eden Prime's video feed. And as Shepard loses consciousness, have it explained visually or through dialogue later, that Cerberus has been tracking Shepard and witnessed the event, which would have tied in with the elusive man's words.
Then see to it that we don't lose him.
There are multiple ways Mass Effect 2's story could have achieved its goals for a darker narrative, but the opening is representative of the storytelling. Heightened drama, regardless of its necessity. Shepard dies. Ashley and Caden think you're a traitor. Cerberus set you up. The Normandy's invaded. But none of these add up, and only the Normandy's invasion affects the plot, and that's easily solved. We already met with Captain Anderson and the Council, who kindly reinstated Shepard's Spectre status, so the only thing accomplished with Ashley or Caden's reaction to Shepard on Horizon is stirring conflict with a former companion, and due to how the story is framed, that conflict doesn't lead to anything beyond a character being emotional. Had the Order of Horizon and meeting the Council had flipped, this conversation could have been a moment where Anderson and the Council's trust of you hinges on Ashley or Caden's word, and thus, your first impression on them. Instead, Shepard's accused of being a traitor after preventing even more deaths on the colony, being told that you turned your back on everything the Alliance stood for. The same Alliance that's been letting humans be liquefied for 2 years. Similarly, the Collector base lays out the premise of stepping into a Cerberus or Collector trap, even though it's the most obvious ambush in galactic history. But it's set up in this fashion. Also, Cerberus can be cited later as a corporation to not be trusted, and reaffirming the elusive man's nefarious actions. Ignoring the plot hole of not sending coordinates of the ship to the Alliance or Council, as Mass Effect had a similar gap with Sovereign's lack of evidence in a universe with helmet cams, the push for this one-note drama overrides an opportunity to combine story and gameplay in a way that affects the endgame. The Collectors could have tried to bait Shepard with the elusive man informing you of the opportunity to collect data on the enemy and escape before Shepard's taken, possibly making it a timed mission where the player needs to collect as much data as possible or use the squad leader mechanic that comes into play later during the suicide mission. Having the information be vital to your success in the end, effectively raising the stakes of both your future and current missions. The Normandy's invasion does attempt something similar, but to far less of an extent. How much of the ship's crew returns after the in-game depends on how quickly you hunt down the Collectors after this attack, but unless the player hadn't already taken care of the loyalty missions beforehand, it's easy to attack the Collectors immediately after this invasion. The Collectors' boarding of the Normandy is also the most tacked-on level in the main quest. The explanation for Shepard and his squad's absence is in order to go somewhere, that's never specified, Shepard brings their entire squad onto a shuttle so he can decide who to bring with them when they get there. Contrived isn't strong enough. The least that could have been done was to give Shepard's destination, but it can't even do that, relegating Shepard's entire side of the story to off-screen. And once again, it wasn't necessary. The Collectors could have invaded with Shepard on board, and you fight your way through the Normandy level by level to activate Edie, something that amps up the drama while combining gameplay alterations to make your missions in the main quest stand out. Only 5 missions in the main quest don't involve recruiting or helping squadmates, and with the exception of Freedom's Progress, all suffer from these melodramatic plot devices and contrived exposition. With the nearly 24 missions involving your squadmates, it's pretty clear that the recruitment and loyalty missions are where BioWare's writing staff spent the bulk of their attention, and generally to good cause, because it's here that the writing in both world-building and character is just as, if not stronger, than its predecessor. Judging by plot connection, Morden is the only significant contributor, but in terms of variety and personality, Mass Effect 2's got one of the best ensembles out there. Everyone, except Jacob, has a unique past, appearance, and persona. Just as before, the most fun in Mass Effect 2 is listening to these characters, discussing their personal lives, professions, or history of their race. Subjects in these conversations tackle anything from father and motherhood, to politics, religious beliefs, to artificial intelligence, and more. Some characters even become a beacon for their people to the player. Thane's wholly responsible for witnessing the blessing and curse of perfect memory. Samara exposes a rare and brutal side to the Asari as a Justicar. Jack and Miranda demonstrate the opposites of a Cerberus upbringing. Grunt serves as an emotional reverse of Rex. But the best example of all is Legion. Without this character, it's hard to imagine the Geth being such an integral part of the Mass Effect trilogy. This single character changes our entire perception of these machines, instilling a sense of innocence and alien thought, depending on the context of each scene or discussion. It's with characters like Legion that Mass Effect 2 does feel like a true continuation of the previous game. Tali's loyalty mission is also a great example, being both a deeply personal journey for your companion and an introduction to the Quarian species as a player. Having known one personally from the first game, visiting the flotilla firsthand and shouting down the leaders of their people does wonders for educating the player on the species and how they fit into the galactic community. And the loyalty mission takes the excellent pacing and story reveals from Mass Effect's Normandy conversations and applies them to Tali's personal story, always keeping the player guessing from one reveal to the next. That pacing generally goes for most of these loyalty missions, and even the worst of the bunch still has an interesting concept, making it understandable why the writers explored it. What hurts these loyalty missions the most is the game's morality system. Tali's adapts to both Paragon and Renegade sensibly, and leads to two unique ways of dealing with the Quarian admirals. But in the case of Garrus or Zaid, their stories only develop the characters on the path of a Paragon. Playing as a hero leads to further revelations and conflict during the story, whereas an anti-hero, your companion gets the revenge and the story cuts off. And as already discussed, some, such as Legions, are forced to arbitrarily label decisions as one or the other, even if the scenario doesn't logically support it. Though when it comes to logic, the main issue stems from the loyalty mechanic itself. It's binary and unable to determine some characters are professional enough or robotic enough that they should be prepared for this mission, but let's play ball and agree it's the case. Byram must have realized that characters without loyalty were likely due to players not caring enough about them in the first place, so in order to keep players on edge and have them potentially lose someone they care about, they allow the lack of one character's loyalty to affect others despite having no connection. After going through the Omega-4 relay and landing on the Collector base, Shepard's first decisions are selecting a tech expert and a squad leader. Selecting one out of three viable characters who are both loyal obviously results in success, but a disloyal hacker catches a round to the head. This is rather contrived, as hacking a door somehow alters a Collector's ability to score headshots, rather than something that's in their direct control. But what's worse is that a loyal tech expert is killed in the exact same way if you select a squad mate who's disloyal. Not only does it nullify the possibility that the tech's own efficiency is affected by their loyalty, but it also disconnects the Normandy's dialogue entirely. Garrus and Jack point out that no one trusts Miranda as a squad leader, but if you select her, and she's loyal, everyone survives. If you select Zaid, who's founded the Blue Suns, the tech expert dies. Other decisions are just as arbitrary and nonsensical, such as Miranda or Jack's argument determines whether or not they can maintain a biotic field, and a former STG Solarian can't handle himself in a firefight. While the suicide mission is a unique concept and hasn't been done in this particular way before or since to my knowledge, none of the decisions here add up in either gameplay or story. Once again, they're put in place for the sake of melodrama. But this also stems from how the suicide mission is even structured. Charging in at full speed isn't a decision, it's a requirement. Being able to select multiple pathways to the Collector base based on what ship upgrades you have, or gathering intel on what's specifically at the Galactic Core through sending probes are all designs that could have made the mission more dynamic. Mass Effect 2 is seemingly about choice, but in the final mission, there aren't any decisions, but instead, correct or incorrect. Rather than a forked pathway, it's a math test. Answer all of these screens correctly, and you complete the mission with no injuries, damages, or deaths. At worst, a couple of crew members suffering from PTSD, but that's a vacation compared to the alternative. Finally, there's one last revelation in the plot, and that's the Collectors have been capturing humans in order to make a human Reaper. Unfortunately, the explanation for this abomination is minimal at best. Somehow liquefying humans allows the Collectors to absorb the essence of a species in this Reaper. Compared to Sovereign's conversation in Mass Effect, this plot revelation doesn't have nearly as much impact or significance. Without this thing, the Reapers are going to invade regardless, and one Reaper out of hundreds, if not thousands, doesn't mean a lot in the grand scheme of things. And the fight against it is bog standard, and has no connection to the antagonist that's been taunting you throughout the entire game. After defeating the human Reaper, it's revealed that Harbinger isn't the Collector's leader, but an actual Reaper that's been controlling the Collector General all along. But that same reveal could have been accomplished with Harbinger taking control of the unfinished structure, not only surprising the player, but also allowing for a conversation similar to Sovereign's. In the final product, there's no equivalent of either antagonist from Mass Effect, and it's sorely missed. The goosebumps I get in the ending are due to the amazing music, sound design, and cinematic. All of those are great in that moment, but the main plot isn't capable of working with these enhancements. Mass Effect 2's presentation is leaps and bounds ahead of the original. Cinematography is akin to television and film, locations are packed with detail, and the lighting is immaculate, and a large reason why this game's visuals hold up better than most. All of the bland corridors and stretched out textures are out, and reused assets are far more camouflaged and purposeful. The work put into each environment, as well as the variety from the post-apocalyptic Krogan home of T'Chanka to the seedy underbelly of Omega and the lush forests of an isolated planet, is profound. It's hard to believe that Mass Effect 2 utilizes the same engine that powered its predecessor. Artistically and technically, it's a feast for the eyes, and a treat for the ears. Jack Wall and Sam Helick were proud of their work on Mass Effect, but with the hectic development and last-minute creation of cinematic scores, Jack was only looking to improve. From the start, he convinced BioWare to designate him as lead composer right off the bat, and knowing the game's structure, was able to hand off individual levels to his team of composers. Sam Helick returned, as did David Cates, and a newcomer, Jimmy Hinson, was thrilled at the opportunity to work on something with the scale and budget of Mass Effect 2. Being able to playtest and coordinate with the audio director, and beginning with a set team from the start, resulted in a score that improved not only instrumentally, but with integration. All of the sound mixing errors and repetitive loops were removed, allowing the music to properly enhance the experience. And it does. Each character has their own score, allowing every recruitment mission to stand out in audio rather than just their visuals. It elegantly handles the variety of atmosphere and tone in Mass Effect 2, knowing when to uplift, and when to isolate. But Mass Effect 2's masterpiece is without a doubt the suicide mission theme.
Suicide Mission, to me, is the best thing I've ever been a part of in any video game, because it came through exactly as I imagined it would. It feels good to watch it. It was like a huge grand finale of the game, and I was really happy about that. You don't get that every day.
Whether it was due to the new staff or simply EA's vast resources, the production of Mass Effect 2 is no longer rough around the edges. It's slick and stylish with breathtaking scenery and superb cinematics. Conversations were well paced in the original, and now that precision is immersed in the camera angles as well. And because each character is unique in personality, that only carries over to the camera work. It's one of the biggest reasons why I think Zaid and Kasumi aren't as memorable despite having equally strong character and backstories to the rest of the crew. You aren't able to get a sense of who they are and how conversations are presented. There isn't an equivalent of the calming maturity of Samara or the darkness of Subject Zero, though it's not always in sync with the dialogue. The easiest example is with Miranda. Mass Effect 2 characterizes her as the Ice Queen, or
pure cold-hearted bitch.
But her demeanor, at least around Shepard, fades almost immediately and is practically non-existent after her loyalty mission. It's one of the reasons I enjoy Miranda's character, that someone who is seemingly following an archetype actually has a personal and interesting background. But the cinematic team apply that femme fatale description during conversations about the danger her sister's in or picking up a radio. They and other shots are appreciated, but it's an oversight that makes it harder to take certain moments seriously. A neat fix would have been to have these camera angles reserved for male Shepard that coincide with Miranda's interest in him. In fact, each mission and character would have greatly benefited with that sort of registration. Missions are often presented as if the other squad members don't exist. Liara doesn't say anything to Tali or Garrus. Miranda's lines in Pragya aren't unique. Samara has no qualms about letting innocence burn to ash with Zaid. The game does have character-specific dialogue on occasion, but typically used for humor rather than conflict.
You? I said a badass, not some scout whining like a quarian with a tummy ache.
I'm standing right here.
I suspect these lines were dreamed up later in development as they applied to scenes or environments in such a way that wouldn't eat much time into the cinematic team. It's a shame because with this dynamic, loyalty could have been an integral theme for the story rather than a simple mechanic. Mass Effect 2's story isn't a sequel to the original, but rather a short story collection. An excellent short story collection. But the main plot connecting everything is rather thin, and doesn't take advantage of what Mass Effect set up with the Prothean Visions, Alliance in the Council, or most importantly, Shepard. The protagonists of Mass Effect didn't have the depth of their companions, but there was development of an Alliance officer becoming the heroic Spectre. Mass Effect 2 lacks this. Shepard doesn't evolve, nor does the commander properly acknowledge their return from the dead. BioWare only made avatars prior to Mass Effect, and their inexperience with established player characters shows in Shepard's lack of growth. It's understandable that there needs to be flexibility with a player character, but that shouldn't prevent emotional scenes about Shepard from existing. The amount of time Shepard's asked a personal question can be counted on one hand, and often with a casual tone of small talk. Ultimately, Mass Effect 2 expands on the universe with deeply personal tales while presenting them with precision and attention to detail that wasn't possible in 2007. But the style doesn't have a main story to benefit. Loyalty missions are effectively main quests, both in their presentation and necessity for keeping your team alive. The real equivalent to Mass Effect's Uncharted Worlds are the N7 missions. Taking place in the Terminus, these side missions often involve shady corporations, mercenaries, and colonies. But unlike Mass Effect's Uncharted Worlds that often confronted themes never explored during the main quest, these three subjects are explored in the main quest, with Ilium, Omega, and Horizon being amalgams of all, and they have a far different pace. Uncharted Worlds had their tedium and occasionally infuriating encounters, but often had some form of payoff with a thought-provoking ending pertaining to the Geth, AIs, or biotics. None of these N7 missions reach that height. There is a brief encounter that plays sort of like a miniature version of Bring Down the Sky. Batarian terrorists plan to destroy a colony, and when defeated, Shepard has to choose between destroying the industrial district that assists the Alliance or the residential district for the colonists. But all that results in is a static TV screen, head turns, and a fade to black. Mass Effect was made to eliminate the imaginative element of role-playing games, but the side quests gave in and used text blocks to deliver their message, and while it was cumbersome and archaic, it still resonated on some level. In Mass Effect 2, the game uses text to deliver the narrative, but only through in-universe items such as datapads. This would lead to a more immersive experience if the missions didn't end on such a low note, often attempting to use an explosion to deliver some sense of urgency, and yet I can't help but notice Shepard's silence throughout its entirety. There's no beating around the bush. Some of these missions are woeful. Sinmara's a planet whose mission amounts to pressing three buttons to activate a shield. Its plea that the mission saved an entire colony is pitiful, and only makes one long for the implications of Luna's rogue VI or the guest transmission of their creator's songs. Only two of these missions do build up their isolated atmosphere effectively and entail something greater. The first involves a rogue VI and virus that's connected to a certain line of mechs, and the second pertains to the Blue Suns and how they're unethically retrieving cargo. Both are a letdown when the former ends with hitting a giant off switch, and the latter ends with Shepard just blowing up the facility. In fact, he does that a lot throughout these skirmishes. The Blue Suns have some half-decent combat encounters, and the rogue VI has a gracefully eerie tone, but echoing science fiction horror isn't new for the franchise. The Blue Sun's quest is even mean enough to use Shepard's Prothean visions, only to reveal the twist that's seen in the main plot by the Collector's ship. Environments are admittedly beautiful, and reused assets have gone from egregious to an art form in how seamlessly they blend in. Mass Effect could have very much benefited from the variety in visuals and landscapes here. But when some of these missions amount to killing a few Varan and taking a Quarian in a shuttle, it's hard to appreciate the art team's efforts, because for the most part, these missions are a chore, and with absolutely no payoff. No amount of light rays can shake the notion that these missions are a step backwards from Mass Effect. BioWare misjudged the resources needed for downloadable content with Mass Effect, expanding the universe with only one package, Bring Down the Sky. Pinnacle Station doesn't count. Comparatively, Mass Effect 2 released the largest number of single-player add-ons in the franchise, and being a part of EA during the pre-order bonus epidemic that's hardly faded, the Cerberus Network, as it was called, included the Arc Projector, Flamethrower, Eviscerator Shotgun and Cerberus Armor, Zaid, and the Normandy Crash Site. You know, little things. Zaid's an entertaining character, and his loyalty mission is of the quality set by the base game. Just as with Garrus, the character doesn't really have an arc on the Renegade path, but at least he gets his beautifully cheesy Hollywood moment.
Fry, you son of a bitch.
I've always suspected that the Cerberus Network locked off content from the main game, but what makes me pause that thought is Zaid's dialogue on the ship. Had the character been installed from day one and given equal treatment to the other characters, I don't see why he wouldn't have his own dialogue scenes like the others, instead of the snippets we get through prompts. Regardless of the intention or purpose of his existence, Zaid amuses and engages, but the DLC scope means that he isn't able to get the attention he deserves. The Normandy crash site is one of Mass Effect 2's highlights, but more by the power of nostalgia and personal attachment to the ship. Judging from a gameplay and design perspective, it's rather minimal and dull, but the atmosphere and flashbacks are effective for those that spent so much time on the ship in Mass Effect. Even Navigator Presley gets a small arc from reading his damaged data logs. What's mainly lacking in this content is something that Mass Effect 2 lacks in general, and that's a connection with Shepard. Your character commanded this ship and its crew, and it's disappointing to not see a greater connection between them and the starship. Something to hint at the locker scene with the romantic interest, or the comm station where he or she hung up on the council. Just a few details to connect with our character and their actions. But still, it's a solid mini-level that delivers on its goals of nostalgia and tribute. Firewalker includes 5 missions that all involve the Hammerhead, Mass Effect 2's replacement for the Mako. Having received boatloads of criticism about the vehicle's physics and bizarre traction, BioWare's response to the latter was to remove traction entirely, with your vehicle hovering above ground. Instead of being used for exploration, the Hammerhead is used to platform between great distances and high altitudes. It's a neat idea, but what's lacking is a sense of necessary input. The Hammerhead flies so high and goes so fast that there's not much for the player to express or get creative with when they don't need to use any to complete these levels. And in response to the Mako's poor aiming, the Hammerhead uses rockets that curve to your target, meaning you only need to point in the general direction of your enemies. BioWare's response to the Mako's troubles simply go too far in the opposite direction and make the Hammerhead's capabilities and inputs so one-note that there's nothing to engage the player. And the physics aren't foolproof either. The downforce felt while speed boosting is overly sensitive to minute bumps, leading to your death on occasion. And the missions themselves are forgettable, serving little more than platforming sections and a story that's of the quality seen in the N7 quests. The ending concludes with you discovering a Prothean artifact that does nothing other than sit in your cabin taunting you. At risk of blaspheming, I think the Hammerhead's a step backwards from the Mako. At least its cannon was capable of disintegrating targets. To the real meat and potatoes, there's Kasumi's stolen memory, incorporated almost exactly the same as Zaid, right down to being bought out and using their personal story to deal with Cerberus. Kasumi's loyalty mission is very enjoyable, with a unique opening that sees Shepard echoing James Bond, impressing a criminal while collecting dirt on him. It's rather simplistic, but effective enough. Though it would have been nice to have a silenced pistol just to sell the spy fantasy further. There's great references to artworks from Earth and other homeworlds that make me wish you could have brought another companion with you. Hearing Tally or Garrus banter about their people's art would have made for even more hilarity in an already pretty lighthearted mission. Kasumi herself is a very likable character with a fun personality that's a neat contrast from some of the darker characters, being a young but confident woman who doesn't carry the shyness from Tally or Liara. But as with Zaid, her prompts just don't engage as much as other characters' conversations, and it puts her at a disadvantage. Oddly enough, one of the things that stood out for me about Stolen Memory is the score. Its melody and tone is Mass Effect, but somehow is more vibrant and cunning, and it beautifully builds in layers in tandem with the mission's stakes. Solid content overall. Overlord attempted to combine the loose structure of Mass Effect's Uncharted worlds with Mass Effect 2's polish and action. The blend is potent, but in doing so results in a rather been-there-done-that feel with the gameplay. And as mentioned, the Hammerhead's bland platforming and occasional combat are a snore, and its required usage doesn't score points. The atmosphere is as beautiful as it is eerie, with Shepard tracking down a rogue interface. What at first appears to be another rerun of the Rogue VI storyline that's been done twice between both games, it's quickly revealed that this Cerberus experiment involved the Geth and the project leader's autistic brother. Overlord's most notable for its ending when revealing the horrific state of its victim, and the appalling actions of the project leader's use of his own brother's genius mathematical capabilities for an experiment that mentally and physically tortured him. Though it also highlights the issue I brought up before, where Shepard is briefly separated from his team while he's hit with Matrix vision, and no one says a word. As with Stolen Memory, a solid piece of downloadable content. Lair of the Shadow Broker is one of the most highly praised DLC packs in BioWare's history, and generally for good reason. It's considerably denser than the previous add-ons, and even features some new gameplay elements, if only for set pieces. The questionably silent companions have been remedied with plenty of amusing banter between Liara and Shepard that carries over to the next game. The only annoyance is once again how some conversations desperately want you on the Paragon path and don't seem to be written for any other outcome other than for Shepard to interrupt this character. But the story intrigues with twists, betrayals, and a strong setup for Liara's place in the next game. It completes her arc that had many confused as to what happened to her innocent personality, with some of that coming back after she satisfies her revenge. There's also plenty of bonus content with a new hub, amusing video clips, and details on all of your squadmates and friends, ranging from heartbreaking to gut-busting hilarity. The environments are breathtaking, with detail in its lighting that may even surpass the base game. By and large, this content deserves its praise. A claim that was not granted to Arrival, Mass Effect 2's final piece of downloadable content, that sees Shepard preventing an imminent Reaper invasion. The contrivance in Arrival's story implies a desperation from BioWare on how to get Shepard where they need him or her to be in Mass Effect 3. What made Lair of the Shadow Broker work is that it was a small personal story with greater implications, whereas Arrival sets up very high stakes without the gameplay or narrative to support it. Hackett's friend Dr. Kenson feels like a throwaway character, and her indoctrination is rather contrary to the previous game, where she's able to hold a conversation one moment and assuming direct control in the next. Using a mech is pretty neat, but that brief moment is hardly worth mentioning in an add-on that doesn't really add anything. Levels are unimpressive corridor slogs, and Shepard being on his own doesn't stand out the way Overlord's Hammerhead focus or Lair of the Shadow Broker's traps did. It only makes each battle that much more of a drag without any companions to assist. If BioWare had the opportunity to use Lance Henriksen for more than his brief appearance in the beginning and end, the mission could have had him communicating with Shepard during the mission. Set it up like Metal Gear's Snake and Otacon, where Admiral Hackett assists with intel in tipping you off that something's wrong with Kenson. Maybe even have some conflict with Shepard wanting to save the Batarians while Hackett confirms there's nothing that can be done. Something to amp up the conflict and tension in a mission that should be heart-pounding, but is just a bore. It's interesting to put Shepard in a position where they don't save the day, but the lengths to go to with knocking him out with a lame betrayal doesn't do the concept justice. Ignoring Firewalker, this is easily the weakest DLC of Mass Effect 2's collection. BioWare took many lessons from these add-ons, and some of it even applies to the next game. For the most part, the content is nearly at the level of Mass Effect 2's quality, in the case of Lair of the Shadow Broker, is equal or better. But the lack of character and interaction in some of these packs only confirms that it's still the character and story that carries the experience, instead of gameplay. Gaming's 7th generation had witnessed a change, one that involved two opposite genres envying the strengths of the other. Role-playing games took inspiration from the best-selling action titles, meanwhile action was inspired by the progression and growth of role-playing. Many games took a step towards the other, but Mass Effect 2 was one of the leaps. BioWare's new budget and partnership also meant a new direction. They were confident in their storytelling ability while being less so in their gameplay. Mass Effect 2's focus in response to the criticism of its predecessor is understandable, but the game knee-jerks in cases where it should have iterated. The Mako, equipment, menus, and skill trees were looking to be improved rather than discarded entirely, and with the sequel starring Shepard, should build off of its predecessor rather than focusing on short stories that, while personal, contribute to the universe and not the plot. Mass Effect 2 is a title I've played extensively and don't regret. The characters, stories, and world are entertaining and heartwarming to this day. The package as a whole is one of 2010's best, and it generally stands on its own years later. But it's not an all-out improvement over Mass Effect. Lots has been lost from game to game, and not simply the nerdy tech trees and stat management. The flexibility in player expression in and out of combat has been swapped for mechanics that, while more polished, are universal to games of the time. Mass Effect 2 is not the franchise peak. Once again, the game itself is outshined by the universe created. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this content, check out my other videos. If you'd like to hear me in conversation rather than narration, you can watch a Rocket League Funtage by my friend Matt and listen to the All Skulls On podcast. Special thanks to Joshua Riddle, James, Aikupa Chupai, Keegan Chua, Jeff Powers, Tinfoil Pancakes, Kevin Cholzone, Reality Escape, Rob Baker, Aaron Esser, Comfy Hat, Andrew Kennedy, Tiernan McCarthy, Scion of the Emperor, Yuhan Yang, Osage, Jeremy Von Amid, Kleinstiff, Frozen Farewell, Alex Turnage, Jay Flint, Joseph Chung, Keaton Butlick, and my other wonderful patrons that helped make this video possible.